And we have the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, Paul said in 1 Corinthians.
Thanks be unto God, which giveth us. We didn't earn it. We didn't accomplish it. Christ did. Thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And in the context, he's talking about victory over death. We're going to be in Daniel 6 this morning. Daniel chapter number 6. As Bible-believing Christians, we should rejoice daily in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Paul said he was delivered for our offenses, but was raised again for our justification. And he said in 1 Corinthians 15, he said, if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Thank God he is raised. Our faith is not in vain. And if we've trusted him, we're not in our sins. Now, we should be rejoicing in that every day. And of course, also, one of the reasons we meet on the first day of the week is because that is the day Christ rose from the dead. We see a precedent there in the book of Acts of disciples meeting on the first day of the week. So in a sense, every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. Now, we certainly do not celebrate the resurrection of Christ just once a year. The religious world celebrated Easter back on the 27th of March. But according to the scriptures, Christ died on Wednesday, not Friday, by the way, Wednesday, April the 14th, and he arose Sunday, April the 18th. Actually, the only person in the Bible that observed Easter was a pagan king, and what he was observing had nothing to do with the resurrection of Christ. That's Acts chapter 12, verse 4. And if you'd like some more information, of course, we've taught on this before, but more information on the actual origin of Easter, we did a blog post on that on March 27th. But it's more fitting to commemorate, I think, the resurrection of Christ today, Sunday, April the 17th, than it was back on the 27th of March. Now, we read about the life, death, and resurrection of Christ in prophetic scripture written hundreds of years before his birth, plain declarations about who he would be and what he would do, but there are also types and pictures of Christ throughout the Old Testament. For example, we know the real historical person, Jonah, and that's not a legend. He was a real historical person, a prophet. We know that Jonah, what happened to him was a picture that pointed to Christ, and we know that because that's what Christ said. In Matthew chapter 12, verse number 39, he said, "But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas." And what was that sign? "For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth." And there are other pictures in the Old Testament. We see, I think, a picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ actually in Daniel chapter 6. And so today we're going to read through the chapter and see how that literal historical events, which took place over 500 years before Christ was born, presents a detailed picture of Christ in his first advent. Now, the Bible again and again and in so many ways proves itself to be the Word of God. Only God can write history in advance with perfect precision, not only saying what's going to happen, but taking historical events and making them a picture of what's going to happen. And the book of Daniel, of course, is a book of prophecy. It's full of prophecy. But even in the first half, when you have these historical events, these stories actually provide pictures of prophecy, like in Daniel 3, with the three Jews that were delivered out of the fiery furnace for not worshiping the image of the king. That's a picture of the godly remnant of Israel not bowing down to the Antichrist and being delivered out of the great tribulation. And so there are stories in the first part of Daniel, but they're real, they're literal, they're historical, and they also are prophetic in what they represent. Now here in Daniel 6, let me briefly remind you that Daniel was just a youth whenever Judah was taken into captivity and he was taken to Babylon. And he was a very godly man of great character, and the Lord used him mightily for many years during the reign of several different Gentile kings. And so when we come here to Daniel 6, it's got to do with the king of the Medes and Persians, Darius. And at this time, Daniel is somewhere over 80 years old when these events take place. So there's a lot in this chapter, and we may make some practical application for you and I as far as our Christian life is concerned, but primarily today the emphasis is on how what we're about to read is a picture of Jesus Christ. That's the emphasis today. And so we read in chapter 6, verse 1 through 3, something of the greatness of Daniel. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. And it was a vast kingdom. And over these three, presidents. So there'd be 120 princes, but there'd be three presidents who would be over the princes. Of whom Daniel was first. So basically, he's second in command only to the king. That the princes might give accounts unto them, and the king should have no damage. And the king knew he could trust Daniel to make sure things were being done right. He was a righteous man. And some of these rulers may try to commit fraud and corruption. And so Daniel was there to make sure that wouldn't happen. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king thought to set him over the whole realm. Now, that's twice in the book of Daniel we read that he was of an excellent spirit. And if you're wondering what that is about, go back to chapter 5 where it said of him he had an excellent spirit. It gives some more detail. Look in verse 11. And this was under the reign of Belshazzar, where Daniel interpreted the handwriting on the wall. It says in verse 11, "There is a man in thy kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy gods." And a kind of maybe an implication that they somehow knew that there was a Godhead. Nebuchadnezzar knew there was the Son of God. He saw him in the fiery furnace. The spirit of the holy gods, and in the days of thy father. Now look at this is his excellent spirit. Light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, was found in him. Whom the king Nebuchadnezzar, thy father the king, I say, thy father made master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers, for as much as an excellent spirit and knowledge and understanding. That excellent spirit, and by the spirit we know things. And Daniel was connected to the spirit of God. And Daniel could interpret things. He knew things. He had wisdom. He had understanding. He had knowledge. For as much as an excellent spirit and knowledge and understanding, interpreting of dreams and showing of hard sentences and dissolving of doubts. That's a great thing. I like that statement. Dissolving of doubts. And by the way, the Word of God dissolves doubts when you believe it. Were found in the same Daniel whom the king named Belteshazzar. Now let Daniel be called and he will show the interpretation. Of course he did. So again, it said that he had an excellent spirit. So in these first three verses of chapter 6, you see something about the character and the position of Daniel. He was first. He was preferred above all. He had an excellent spirit, and he was appointed to be set over the whole realm of the kingdom. Now, it doesn't take a whole lot of thinking to realize that points you to someone much greater. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 1, verse 14, it says, "The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glories of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." No man like that. There have been men that were gracious and truthful, but Christ alone was full, absolutely full of grace and truth. John bear witness of Him and cried, saying, "This was He of whom I spake, He that cometh after Me." And Jesus was born 6 months after John. "He that cometh after Me is preferred," notice that, "preferred before Me." John's just the forerunner. He's just a voice announcing the Savior, the Lord Jesus. "He is preferred before Me, for He was before Me." Jesus said, "Before Abraham was, I am." Look in John 3, verse 30. "He must increase," John the Baptist said. "He must increase, Lord Jesus, but I must decrease." That's a, by the way, that's a great application for us, if we're going to serve the Lord, it ought to be more and more each day about Him and less about us. He that cometh from above is above all. You see the language here tied back to Daniel 6, preferred above all, first. He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly, and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all. And what he hath seen and heard, that he testifieth, and no man receiveth his testimony. But people not receiving it didn't change the fact what he said was true. He that hath received his testimony hath set to his seal that God is true. For he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. He was absolutely full of the Holy Ghost. The Father loveth the Son and hath given all things into his hand. Daniel, they said he had an excellent spirit. Well, the Lord Jesus has the seven spirits of God. There's one God in three persons. There's one Holy Spirit, but there's seven spirits of God. You say, explain that. Why do I have to explain that? I'm just telling you what the Bible says. But the Bible in Revelation 5, verse 6, refers to Christ having the seven spirits of God. And I know that in Isaiah chapter 11, it refers to his kingdom, and it says, there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And seven spirits of God here. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might. That reminds you of what it was said about Daniel. The spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. You know, the Bible said in Colossians 1:18 that he has the preeminence. It said Daniel is first, Christ is first. And so you see some things about Christ in the life of Daniel. Notice again in Daniel 6, beginning in verse 4. Well, let's just read verse 4. So first of all, the greatness of Daniel, but now notice the envy of the princes. Verse 4, then, after it was said Daniel was exalted and promoted, then the presidents and princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom. And they were looking at anything they could to accuse him. They're trying to get rid of him. Daniel, it said they could find none occasion nor fault. That's an amazing statement about a human being. They could find none occasion nor fault, for as much as he was faithful, neither was there any error or fault found in him. Now, that points me again to Jesus Christ. It's not hard to see this, is it, as you look at the passage? The presidents and princes were against Daniel for two main reasons. First of all, they were envious of his position. And secondly, they realized that with him over them, they would not be able to get away with fraud and corruption. And so the envious leaders sought to find fault in him, but could not. And likewise, the corrupt Jewish leaders saw the righteousness of Christ. They saw his great works. They heard him preach the truth with all authority. And there was a great multitude following him, and they were envious. The Bible says very plainly they were envious of him. They were in spiritual darkness, and they were being reproved by his shining light. And they went about looking for any fault that they could find in him to use against him, but they could find none, for he was faultless. He was without error. He's the sinless Son of God. In Mark 15, it says in verse 9 and 10, but Pilate answered them, saying, will you not release on you the king of the Jews? For Pilate knew that the chief priest had delivered him for what? Envy. And that's what these presidents and princes have in this passage. They're envious. And envy will lead you to do some awful things against those you're envious of. John 8:46, Jesus said, which of you convinceth me of sin? I mean, it doesn't matter who you are. Anybody that stands up and says that, it don't take very long for us to convince you of sin. Can you imagine me standing up this morning saying, which of you convinced me of sin? I mean, it wouldn't take very long, would it? Look, we know we're sinners, but Jesus is no sinner. Which of you convinced me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do you not believe me? Luke 23:4, then said Pilate to the chief priests and to the people, And here's the testimony of Pilate about Jesus. I find no fault in this man. And you see the same language here in Daniel chapter number 6. Look in verse 5. In verse 5 through 9, we see the conspiracy against Daniel. So first of all, his greatness, and then the envy, but now the conspiracy. Verse 5, then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Then these presidents and princes assembled together to the king and said thus unto him, King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the princes, the counselors and the captains, have consulted together to establish a royal statute. That's a lie. Daniel wasn't in on this. See? And the king evidently thought Daniel was, and if he would have known Daniel wasn't, I guarantee he would have thought twice about the thing. And so he said, they said that whosoever, it says, and to make a firm decree, that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save thee, O king. They're buttering a guy up, man. I mean, they're saying, you're like a god to us, and we want to honor you. So they're appealing to his pride, and they're flattering him. They said, if any man ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions. This is idolatry. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing, that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore, King Darius signed the writing and the decree. So they came up with a plot to betray him. They misused the law of God against him. They knew that as a righteous man, he would faithfully pray to God and not commit idolatry by following their decree to pray to the king instead of his God. So they came up with a plan to use his righteousness against him. And likewise, the religious leaders plotted against Christ. And they always were going about trying to catch him in his words. You look in John 8, you see an example how they tried to bring in the law to try to catch him in some kind of wrongdoing. You see it again and again. But at the end, they paid one of the apostles, Judas Iscariot, a devil from the beginning, to betray Christ, and then they set up false witnesses against him. However, the false witnesses did not work because their testimonies did not agree with one another. Basically, they misused the law of God to condemn Christ to death. They claimed he spoke blasphemy because he said he was the Son of God. And that would have been blasphemy had he not been the Son of God. But he was the Son of God, and he spoke the truth. And in Matthew 26, verse 3 and 4, then assembled together. Same language. It's amazing. I mean, how detailed this is. Then assembled together the chief priests and the scribes and the elders of the people under the place of the high priest who was called Caiaphas, and consulted that they might take Jesus by subtlety and kill him. Mark 16, verse 16, the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answerest thou nothing? What is it which these witness against thee? But he held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? Jesus said, I am. What a statement there, right? I am. I'm God. You shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest rent his clothes and saith, what need we have any further witnesses? Ye have heard the man. What think ye? And they all condemned him to be guilty of death. He wasn't put to death because of Roman law, but because of the Jewish law being misused against him. That was the conspiracy. And by the way, conspiracy is a Bible word, and I believe in conspiracy, and I believe there's a major conspiracy within our own government. And by the way, it's in all governments of this world. You're talking about conspiracy. Now, I don't waste a lot of time on the internet trying to read everybody's conspiracy theories because I'll never know fully, and I don't really want to know fully what all's going on. It would shock us if we really knew the type of things that went on behind the scenes. But the Bible tells the truth about things, and the Bible refers to conspiracy. All right, number four. So the conspiracy, but then notice the faithfulness. The faithfulness, look in Daniel 6, verse 10, the faithfulness of Daniel. I love verse 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed. He knew what the decree was, that if he prayed to God, he was going to be cast into the den of lions. What would you do? Think about it. You say, I'd pray in my heart where nobody would know that I was praying. Daniel didn't try to hide it. Now, when Daniel knew that his writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open, in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks. Thankful in these circumstances. He knows what's going to happen to him, and he's given thanks before his God, as he did aforetime. And I like that. See, some people only pray when there's a crisis. Some people only get excited about the things of God when there's pressure or some kind of crisis. Daniel was the same. He had prayed aforetime. It wasn't nothing new for him. And he had the strength to do what he did because he was a man of prayer. And this was scriptural because according to 1 Kings 8, the Jews, in Solomon's dedication of the temple, he talked about praying toward the temple, and he even referred to those who would be in captivity. And so Daniel knew that. And also 3 times a day, Psalm 55:17 tells you what those 3 times were, evening, morning, and at noon. It said, I'll pray. And even in the book of Acts, it talks about the hours of prayer. And so he was praying according to the Word of God. He was scriptural in his prayer, and prayer needs to be scriptural. It needs to be based on your understanding of God's Word. In verse 11, then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God, knowing what would become of him if he prayed to God. Daniel still prayed just as he did before, and he was found praying when the men assembled to take him. Now, Jesus, likewise, knowing that he was betrayed, knowing what awaited him at the Garden of Gethsemane, still went there and prayed. And that's where they found him when they came for him. In John 18, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Kedron, where was a garden to the which he entered and his disciples. And Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus oft times resorted thither, you know, kind of like as he did aforetime, right? He's still doing what he's always been doing. Resorted thither with his disciples. Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? They answered, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said unto them, I am. There it is again. I am he. Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with him, and they all fell over. You'd think they would have got the hint there to leave this man alone. But they continued to do what they were going to do. But the thing is Daniel was faithful. He was faithful despite circumstance. He was faithful despite opposition. He was faithful despite the problem. He was faithful. He kept his eyes on the Lord, and he prayed to the Lord. And there is none more faithful than the Lord Jesus Christ. He is faithful in all things. He said, I do always those things that please him. Talking about the Father. And he was faithful to the very end. And he knew what was going to happen to him. It was planned before the world began. He knew full well what was going to happen to him, yet he went and he prayed. Now look at the accusation in verse 12. The accusation in verse 12, then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree. Hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save of thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? And by the way, stop and think about this. I mean, den of lions. That's pretty major. I mean, these were not like tame type of zoo animals. They kept these beasts hungry and ready to devour. It was a form of execution. They knew whenever they threw people in there, they'd be dead pretty quick. Can you imagine? I mean, what a way to go, to be eaten alive by lions. O king, they shall be cast in the den of lions. The king answered and said, the thing is true, according to the law of Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Then answered they and said before the king that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth not thee. O king, I like that. He wasn't a respecter of persons. He cared what God thought, not about what the king thought. He said, he regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petition three times a day. Then the king, when he heard these words, was sore displeased with himself. Daniel was a great man, and the king wanted to use this man. And he didn't realize what he was doing when he signed that decree, because he was under the impression that Daniel knew about it. So he set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, Know, O king, that the law of the Medes and Persians is that no decree nor statute which the king establisheth may be changed. So they deliver Daniel over to the king, and the king is troubled. He doesn't want to put him in the lion's den. He tries to find a way to deliver him. But the leaders put pressure on the king, and he gives in, and he really doesn't have any choice. And all the while, there's Daniel offering no self-defense, just willing to take whatever comes. Likewise, Jesus was delivered over to Pilate, the governor. And Pilate was troubled because he knew he was innocent. And what did Pilate do? He worked hard. He set his heart on finding a way to deliver Jesus. He offered them Barabbas. They said, no, not him. Kill Jesus. Crucify him. And the leaders put pressure on him, and he gave in. And all the while, Christ offered no defense. In Matthew 27, verse 1 and 2, when the morning would come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. And then down in verse 22, Pilate saith to them, What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all say unto him, Let him be crucified. It was those Jewish leaders that were putting the pressure on him. And the governor said, Why? What evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, Let him be crucified. And so we come now to the execution of Daniel. Look in verse 16. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, Thy God, whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. That's a great testimony. I mean, that is a great, I mean, the king knew that about Daniel. He said, You serve God continually, irregardless of the circumstance. You are faithful. You serve God continually. It says it twice about Daniel in this passage. It reminds me of what Paul said about himself and his ministry to the Ephesian elders. He said, You know what manner I've been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind. And then in Acts 27, on that voyage, when he's told about the shipwreck and what's going to transpire, he's not worried. He's believing God. And he said, The angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. You know, he stood with him. And that's a great testimony to say continually. Now, none of us are perfect. We all have our ups and downs. But there ought to be something about us that's continual in how we serve the Lord. And so often we base things on circumstance and whatever instead of Christ. He is worthy. He is worthy for us to serve Him continually, even when we don't get our way, and even when things aren't like we want them to be. It's about Him, not about us. Daniel served God continually. And it says in verse number 17, And a stone was brought. I mean, if you can't see the picture here, you're blind as a bat flying backwards in a dark cave. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet. And with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. And so the king gives the order for Daniel to be cast into the lion's den, which meant certain death. Look at verse 24, jump ahead. The king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and cast them into the den of lions. And what happened to them? Them, their children, and their wives. By the way, your sin always affects those around you. And the lions had the mastery of them and break all their bones in pieces or ever they came at the bottom of the den. All right, so this was serious. These were trained animals to kill and to devour, and they were kept hungry. And so this meant certain death. Fierce, hungry lions. It was not humanly possible that he'd come out of that den alive. And the king thinks it is possible that God will deliver Daniel. He said, "Thy God, whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee." A large stone is rolled in front of the mouth of the den. And it's sealed with the royal seal. And likewise, Pilate gave the order for Jesus to be crucified. When Christ died on the cross, he entered into the lion's den. Satan is a roaring lion that seeks whom he may devour. And when Christ died on the cross, at that time, Satan still had the power of death. The king of terrors. And it wasn't just Satan himself present at that cross. There were all kind of devils around. And in the crucifixion psalm, Psalm 22, Christ said, "Save me from the lion's mouth." Psalm 22, verse 21. And whenever Christ dismissed his spirit, proving his deity, according to Ecclesiastes 8, verse 8, he gave up the ghost at his appointed will. His soul descended into the heart of the earth, and his body was laid in a borrowed tomb. A large stone was rolled in front of the tomb, and it was sealed with the authority of the Roman Empire. And the seal meant, if you mess with a seal, you mess with the empire. No man would try that, but God doesn't care about the authority of men because he is God and he is over all. And he messed with the seal when he sent his angel to roll the stone away to show he's already risen. It was not humanly possible that Christ would come up alive out of the lion's den. And Pilate made a remark that He thought it was possible, though, that God may deliver him. It's kind of a sarcastic remark in Matthew 27. Pilate said to them, "You have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can." Go ahead and seal the stone. Yeah, go ahead and make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulcher sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. Look in verse 18, the lamentation of the king. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. I think the fasting there is a fasting of sleep. Sometimes fasting in the Bible is not referring to food. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste unto the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel, and the king spake and said to Daniel, "O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions?" He's upset. He's down there first thing in the morning. Likewise, Mary Magdalene in John 20, verse 1, "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark." There goes your sunrise service. By the way, Jesus rose about 6 p.m. on our Saturday. Okay, but at any rate, he was already gone, but she came while it was yet dark unto the sepulcher and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulcher. Down in verse 11, Mary stood without at the sepulcher weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulcher. It reminds me of this king weeping at the den of lions, not sure what would happen if he was killed or not. But look at the deliverance. I love this. Verse 21. Then said Daniel unto the king, Imagine this guy's been in this den of lions all night. The king comes and he's upset. Is your God able to deliver thee? Then said Daniel to the king, O king, live forever. My God hath sent his angel. You know who that was? That was Jesus Christ. Isn't that something? He shows up in the very passage that's a picture of him. How do I know it's Jesus Christ? Because it was the same angel that was sent in the fiery furnace, and the king looked and said, it's the Son of God. He's the angel of the Lord so often in the Old Testament. He said, my God hath sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths. I like that. That they have not hurt me. For as much as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Then was the king exceeding glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel's taken up out of the den, kind of like a resurrection, you know. And no manner of hurt was found upon him. Why? Because he believed in his God. And in Hebrews 11, without faith, it's impossible to please him. And you have the hall of faith and all these examples. And it says in verse 33 that it was through faith some stopped the mouths of lions. He believed in his God. Daniel wasn't focused on the problem. He was focused on God. And God brought the victory, and there was a deliverance of Daniel. And he says that God delivered him because he was innocent. And what a great miracle it was that he was taken up out of the den without hurt. Absolutely astounding. And the king rejoiced to know that he was alive. Well, likewise, God delivered Christ from the mouth of the lion because he was innocent. Christ did not die on the cross for his sins. For had he would have stayed dead because he would have got what he deserved. But he didn't get what he deserved. He was a sacrifice, an innocent sacrifice, dying for our sins. He had no sins. He died for our sins. And he paid the price in full. And because he was an innocent sacrifice, he was raised up from the dead, and he came up out of the lion's den without hurt, so to speak, alive forevermore. The disciples, which had been lamenting, because they didn't understand his crucifixion. They didn't understand what was going on, even though he told them it was hid from them. And they were lamenting. They began to rejoice when they knew that Christ indeed was alive. In John 20, verse 19, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. And when they had so said, he showed to them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. And the king had been lamenting, and now he's rejoicing because Daniel is alive. And how we ought to be rejoicing today, because Christ is alive. He died for our sins. He paid the full price. And God accepted the payment. How do I know that? Because the resurrection's the receipt. Proof of payment. God accepted it. He raised him from the dead because he's innocent, because he is the Savior. And by the way, Christ accomplished this because he believed. It was by faith that Christ went to the cross, believing in the plan that the Godhead had established before the world began. Paul refers to the fact that God promised before the world began eternal life. It was the Father promising the Son, and he believed in the plan and the purpose, and he went to that cross. It said he was obedient unto death. Even the death of the cross, he obeyed by faith and accomplished our redemption, so that when we believe on Christ and accept him as our Savior, the Bible said we are justified by his faith. Thank God for the faith of Christ. You know, the Bible says, and talking about this word innocent, it reminds me of what Peter said in 1 Peter 3:18 about this concerning the cross. He said in 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. He was the just, suffering for the unjust. Why? That he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. And then again, I referred to the faith of Christ. Here's a great gospel verse, Romans 3. In Romans 3, it says, in verse 22, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. The salvation is unto all, but it's only upon them that believe. Upon them that believe. For there's no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. He's risen. He is alive. He's alive forevermore. He's never going to die again. He got the job done. He accomplished the work of redemption. If we believe on Him, we live in Him. We have eternal life now. And if we do die physically before the coming of the Lord, that body will be raised. We live in Christ. But notice, almost done now, verse 24. Notice the destruction of the enemies. So we have the deliverance of Daniel, but notice the destruction of the enemies. Verse 24, and the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions. That's what you call reaping what you sow. The old saying is, what goes around comes around. And they cast into that very den that they wanted Daniel to be in, them, their children, their wives, and the lions had the mastery of them and break all their bones in pieces wherever they came at the bottom of the den. And so the ones that accused Daniel were now destroyed by the same means by which they sought to destroy him. Likewise, Satan, who orchestrated the betrayal and the crucifixion of Christ, he was destroyed by that very death. Paul said, had he known it, he would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Hebrews 2:14 says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. The Bible, Christ was crucified through weakness. An amazing thing. God said, I'll come down there on your turf, Satan, and I will become a man, and I will go into death and use death to defeat you that has the power of death. That is amazing about the power of God. Jews cried out, crucify him. They said, his blood be on us and on our children. And though given an opportunity to repent after the resurrection of Christ, Israel as a nation stubbornly continued to reject their king, and so that in AD 70, Jerusalem was brutally destroyed by the Romans, and the history of the Jewish race ever since has been one filled with destruction. But God's not through. Blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles become in. And it says, all Israel shall be saved. But I was reading the other morning in Thessalonians, and if you want a great verse about the Jews in regard to this present age, now an individual Jew can get saved the same way a Gentile does. But when Paul said, you know what he said about the Jews? He said in 1 Thessalonians 2, in verse number 15, who both killed the Lord Jesus and their own prophets and have persecuted us, and they please not God and are contrary to all men. What a statement. And look at their history since that time. His blood be on us. Yeah, it has been. But God's so merciful and gracious, He's going to save them yet when they repent from what they've done as a nation in killing their Messiah. And they will at the second coming of Christ when they look on Him whom they've pierced. Last this morning, notice the decree of the king. And let's read the final verses. Verse 25. Then King Darius wrote, I love this, it says, then King Darius wrote unto all people, nations and languages that dwell in what? All the earth. What's the first word he wrote unto them? Peace. How about that? A message of peace goes to all the world because of the deliverance of Daniel. Peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and steadfast forever, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth. He worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in the earth, who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius, and even after that in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Well, as a result of Daniel's great deliverance, the decree is sent out to all the world. And again, the first word of it is peace. The decree is made that all people should fear God, glorify Him for who He is and for His great works, and that God has a kingdom that will never be destroyed. And the chapter ends with the statement that Daniel prospered. And likewise, as a result of the resurrection of Christ, God has decreed that the gospel be sent unto all the world, and the message is the message of peace. The Bible says it's the gospel of peace, Ephesians 6:15, and in Romans 4:25 it said, He was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. Therefore, chapter 5, verse 1, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, listen, you have peace in your heart. You have peace with God when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the Lord of peace. And one day He'll come back and set up His kingdom on the earth. Then there will finally be peace on the earth. It said Daniel prospered. You know what that reminds me of? It reminds me of the prophecy in Isaiah 9 about our Lord's kingdom on the earth, where it says, For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon His shoulder, and His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of His government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon the kingdom, upon His kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform. What a blessing that we know the Bible is the Word of God. There ain't no way a man wrote that. Don't get excited or anything, but we just looked at something that happened 500 years before Jesus was born to a literal historical figure named Daniel, and everything that happened to him was a picture of Christ. That's amazing. And that's just one example of many. And all these prophecies, it's mathematically impossible that Christ fulfilled all those prophecies coincidentally. It was no coincidence. This Bible's the Word of God. And everything that was fulfilled in His first advent was fulfilled literally, and everything the Bible says about His second advent will also be fulfilled literally. We know the Bible is the Word of God. We know that Jesus Christ is the Savior of sinners, and we can know for sure that we're saved if we've trusted the Lord as our Savior. My goodness, folks, do you not realize what I just said? Can you take it to heart in who we are in Christ and what He's done for us and all we have in Him? We ought to be the most joyful, the most excited, the most zealous people in all the earth. That's what we ought to be. That is when we have the right priorities and the right perspective. I want to close with 2 Timothy 4. If you look there, and we'll wrap this up with a practical application. The emphasis was on the gospel this morning, but let me give you something practical for Christians. You know, being faithful to God does not mean we'll never have any problems. In fact, if anything, it means your problems will increase. Opposition will increase. Problems will increase. Daniel was faithful no matter the consequences. I like what John Quincy Adams, the sixth president of the United States of America, said. He said, duty is ours, results are God's. In other words, do what's right and leave God the consequences. Great statement. And you know what? Even though we're going to have problems, we can trust God to see us through them all. And in the end, as the song says, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. 2 Timothy 4, we're talking about problems. Look at verse 14. This is how the apostle gives his final words before his death. and he died for his faithfulness. He paid the price, the ultimate price, for his godliness and his faithfulness, and how persecuted he had been, and it finally cost him his head. But he writes toward the end of his life, and these are his final words, basically. He said in verse 14, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. Of whom he be thou ware also. He's warning Timothy about him because he's still out there at Ephesus where Timothy was pastoring. He said, be thou ware also, for he hath greatly withstood our words. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. And yet Paul wasn't bitter. He said, I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. And how about this? And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. There's a roaring lion out there walking about seeking whom he may devour in a practical way. I know 1 Peter 5:8 especially has the tribulation in view, but it's still true that we have an adversary. And Paul said, you better put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. He said, I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. You say, was he talking about the emperor or was he talking about Satan? Well, whatever. I mean, the basic idea was he was delivered out of the opposition because the Lord stood with him. And he said, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. See, that's the thing you got to think on. See, one of these, it doesn't matter what you go through in this life as a Christian. If you're saved, you're going to be reigning in the heavenly kingdom. In other words, you're going to reign with Christ in heavenly places forever and forever. And any of the grief you get now or the problems you get now or whatever or persecution you get now, Paul said that's nothing to be compared to the glory that we're going to have. And so you just got to keep your eyes on the Lord and just keep being faithful in what he's given you to do. He stands with you and he will deliver you. And when you see him, that's all that's going to matter. And I'm looking forward to seeing him. And I hope he comes today. Let's stand together, please.